Good morning, everybody. It's a beautiful Sunday morning here at Columbine Spiritual Center, and we want you to get up and sing with us today. Well, I got up this morning singing,
God is so good.
Trouble, I know
God is so good.
Yeah, in my time of trouble, I know
God is so good.
Yeah, in my time of trouble, I know
God is so good. My God is so good to me.
Well, well, in my time of triumph, I know
God is so good.
Well, in my time of triumph, I know. Every way. Done. We're going to sing about finding the light inside and sharing it. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine.
When there's beauty in the person,
there is harmony in the home.
There is harmony in the home.
When there's harmony in the home,
when there's harmony in the home.
Yeah. Welcome to Columbine Spiritual Center. We're centered in God. We celebrate a world of harmony, peace, and abundance for all. We have a special treat for you today, in addition to these fine singers behind me in this incredible rhythm section, and that is Voce at a Distance, Voices of Columbine Ensemble. They're going to do a song now called Plenty Good Room.
Plenty good room, plenty good room, plenty good room. On the glory train, there's a plenty good room.
There's a
plenty good room, there's a plenty good room. On the glory train,
well, you're gonna need a ticket if you wanna ride.
Plenty good room on the glory train,
but it ain't gonna happen unless you qualify.
Plenty good room on the glory train,
better mind what you say and what you do.
Plenty good room on the glory train,
there's a mighty, mighty power watching over you.
Plenty good room on the glory train,
there's a
plenty good room, plenty good room, plenty good room on the glory train. There's a plenty good room,
there's a
plenty good room, there's a plenty good room on the glory train.
Well, now hear the angel Gabriel shouting, all aboard.
Plenty good room on the glory train.
Glory trains ahead and up to heaven's door.
Plenty good room on the glory train.
There's a long golden pathway reaching toward the sun.
Plenty good room on the glory train.
Now the heavenly glory has just begun.
Plenty good room on the glory train.
There's a
plenty good room, plenty good room. Plenty good room on the glory train. There's a plenty good room.
There's a
plenty good room. There's a plenty good room on the glory train.
Now the train is really running. Hear the clickety clack.
Plenty good room on the glory train.
Mile after mile down the railroad track.
Plenty good room on the glory train.
Big wheels are turning. Everything is fun.
Plenty good room on the glory train. She's never missing a beat and she's arrived on time. Plenty good room on the glory train. Ooh, great God Almighty, hear the angel roar. Plenty good room on the glory train. The world is burning and there's room for more. Plenty good room on the glory train. Ooh, ooh, there's a whistle, what a joyful noise. Plenty good room on the glory train. Next stop will be paradise. Plenty good room on the glory train. Plenty good room,
plenty good room,
plenty good room,
plenty good room
on the glory train. There's a plenty good room,
there's a
plenty good room,
there's a
plenty good room on the glory train.
There's a
plenty good room,
plenty good room,
plenty good room,
plenty good room.
Thank you, Voce. That was wonderful. And so we are officially beginning our service with prayer by lighting our candle. Maybe if I can get the lighter to work. There we go. There. So won't you join me in prayer by taking that deep breath and gently closing your eyes, turning within, going to that place deep within you that knows there's room, plenty good room, plenty good room for you, for us, for all of us to live together in harmony and peace and love. And we bring that to the divine essence of our being. Sweet, loving spirit, in this place of knowing, maybe for just this moment, that we are divine beings, that we have this spark of spirit in us, spark of God in us. We allow ourselves to be in this place of gratitude, this place of curiosity, this place of love and tenderness for everything going on in our world today. It's important to get to know this light inside. Get to know this light that is inside us, inside of every being on this planet, and let it shine. Let it shine, lighting the way to more love, more peace, more freedom, so that our human race can evolve. Evolve to a place where everyone knows there is room for them at the table, where everyone feels loved and knows they are love, where everyone belongs and no one is left out. It can be a tall order, we know, sweet spirit. It can be a really tall order when we look at the world around us. But we have the light inside of us, and we need to get to know it and let it shine. Be a beacon for others who maybe aren't in alignment with their own light yet. We bring this light, we bring this awareness, we bring this love to everyone who is feeling challenged in their lives right now. Everyone who is hurting. Everyone who is sad or angry or in disgust or fearful or not sure of their way. We bring a light of love, a light of peace, a light of joy, knowing that this is ours to do in this moment, in this time. Shining our light brightly. And so it is. Amen.
And this is Voce again, featuring Pete Jacobs on the solo.
One, two, three, four.
You can use anything.
when David fought Goliath, the mighty giant failed. He proved to his people that God was alive.
So beautiful. Thank you, Voce, and thank you, Janice, and what a group, what a beautiful group of souls to come together and do that for us. I was really touched by an article I read yesterday about a couple who's been is the longest married couple on the planet. They live in Ecuador, and they've been married for 79 years. And what's more incredible is the husband is 110 and the wife is 105 years old. And it was so sweet to see them cuddling up together. There was a picture of them on with the story, and they just celebrated their anniversary. And I was just comparing, my husband Kevin and I just celebrated our anniversary on Friday, 11 years. We've got 68 more to go to get to that point, and I don't know that we're going to make it that far just because we're not that young. But, you know, great relationships can really help you see the light. The person you're in a relationship with can help you see the light in yourself when you can't see it. They can point out the good in you when you can't see it in yourself. And that's what great relationships do. I know that's what Kevin and I are able to do for each other a lot of the time, not all the time, but it's something that Arun Gandhi, grandson of Mahatma Gandhi, had that kind of relationship with his grandfather, where they were so close and saw the good in each other, saw that light in each other, and let that light shine, reminded them of it. We're working with the book, The Gift of Anger, by Arun Gandhi, grandson to Mahatma Gandhi. And when he was 12 to 14 years old, he went to India and stayed in the ashram with his grandfather and learned a lot from his grandfather in those 2 years, who actually was killed just weeks after he left there. But one of the stories in this week that I'm looking at, chapter 4, which is about knowing your own worth, is about Arun when he was there, living there, and his grandfather who knew the value of money but chose to live a simple life, knew that he had to have money to do his work, and so one of the things that he sold was his autograph. And many people wanted his autograph, and he sold it for 5 rupees. And so one of Arun's duties when he was living with his grandfather was to collect the books that would be autographed and give them to his grandfather to sign them. And Arun decided that he wanted an autograph from his grandfather too, but he didn't have any money. He didn't have 5 rupees. So he tried to slip in a book unnoticed, without any money, but he couldn't pull the wool over his grandfather's eyes. He said, "Arun, what is this book here? No money, no rupees. I can't sign this book." And Arun said, "Well, that's mine, grandfather." And he said, "I'm not going to sign this book. Where's your money?" He said, "You know I have no money." And his grandfather said, "Well, I'm not going to sign that. We have determined my autograph is worth 5 rupees, and that means it's worth 5 rupees to everyone, including you." And he said, "But I'm your grandson. I should get special treatment." And Mahatma Gandhi said, "No, you should not. Not when we have determined the worth of my autograph." And so they decided it was going to be a challenge between the two of them. Arun decided, "You'll give me your autograph for free. Just wait and see." And Mahatma Gandhi said, "I will not. We will see." And so Arun tried many ways to try to trick his grandfather into giving him that autograph, including barging in on him when he was meeting with diplomats or heads of state, and putting in papers with a group of papers for him to sign, trying to slip in his a book for him to sign as well. And Mahatma Gandhi would have none of it. But when Arun would interrupt his grandfather in these important meetings he had, he would just be very patient with him. "Yes, Arun, what is it? Well, we need this, or I need your autograph, or I need that." And, "No, Arun, you're not getting my autograph without the 5 rupees. And Arun soon learned that he was not going to get that autograph, and he learned what the lesson was about. He learned that it was about you set a value, and you don't back down from that. You have a worth, and that is worth, it's got value. And so Arun finally gave up on getting an autograph for free. His grandfather did write Pabu on one of the things, and Arun said, "That's not good enough." He goes, "Well, that's all you're going to get for free, because you're my grandson. I'll give you that." The battle of the wills. But he got the lesson that Gandhi was worthy. He knew his worth. He would meet with heads of states and diplomats and kings, all dressed in their finery and jewels and crowns, and Gandhi wearing a loincloth. And Arun, at first, was embarrassed for his grandfather that he would be meeting these important people dressed in a loincloth. But he came to realize that Gandhi didn't need finery, didn't need heavy cloaks, crowns, or jewels to determine his worth. He knew his worth. And soon Arun thought that the other ones looked a bit ridiculous in all their finery. We need to know our worth. All of us are worthy way more than we give ourselves credit for, way more valuable. Do you know your worth? Do you know how valuable you are? If you do, write it in the chat box. It's not to boast. It's to know, to stand in that power of knowing that you have a light within you that is wanting to shine. It's knowing that you are valuable. And each of us is valuable. But we don't always see it. There was a young man that walked into the shop of an old wise man. He walked in complaining to the old man that nobody values me. Everybody thinks I'm a failure, and they think I'm worthless. Will you help me? I need to find my worth. And the old wise man said, "I'm in the middle of something right now. I can't do it." And the young man thought, "Well, here's another person not willing to show me my worth." The old man looked at the young man and said, you know, I am in the middle of something, but if you will help me help me with my project, then I will help you after we're done. And so the young man reluctantly agreed. The old wise man took a ring off his finger. It had a gemstone in it. And he said, I need to pay a debt, to settle a debt. I would like you to take this ring and go to the marketplace and try to sell this ring so that I can pay off my debt. But don't take any less than one gold coin for the ring. You can take my horse and just go into the market. And so the young man did. He got on his horse and went to the marketplace and tried to talk to many people about the ring. And he showed it to many people. And everyone that looked at the ring said, I could give you a silver coin for it. I could give you a copper coin for it. But nobody would offer him a gold coin. He talked to hundreds of people at the marketplace and went home feeling, again, a failure, feeling discouraged, feeling worthless because he wasn't able to sell the ring for at least one gold coin. He brought the coin to the old man and told him, everybody says that this ring is not worth one gold coin. The old man said, we need to go to the creator of the ring. We need to go to a jeweler who can give us a true value of this ring. So I want you, young man, to go to this jeweler and ask him the worth of the ring, but don't sell the ring. Just bring it back to me and tell me what he says. So the young man goes off and goes to the jeweler. And the jeweler takes out his scope and he's examining the ring. And he says, I can give you 58 gold coins for it today, but if you could wait a couple days, I could get it to 70 gold coins. The young man was shocked. So he did not sell the ring, but he took it back to the old wise man and told him what the jeweler had told him. And the old wise man said to him, you see, you took it to an expert. You took it to its source. You took it to its creator who knew the value of that ring, who knew it was worth way more than anyone else had thought it was worth. And that's what happens when we go to the outside world for validation, for determining our worth. We need to go to the source. We need to go to the expert. And where is that? But inside us. Inside where our light shines. Inside is that spiritual divine essence that knows our worth. The world will never value us like God will. Hafiz of Persia is a Sufi poet in the 14th century. He said this, I wish I could show you when you are lonely or in darkness the astonishing light of your own being. Do you know the astonishing light of your own being? Do you know how valuable and brilliant you are? Many of us don't. Many of us need reminders of that. A couple weeks ago, Marianne Lawler is one of our volunteers in the Youth and Family Ministry program, and she sent an article to Christopher, who's a director of the YFM program. He sent it to me. And it's an article about the song, This Little Light of Mine. Of course, our beautiful music team sang it this morning for us, This Little Light of Mine. We often think of it as a children's song. And it's attributed to Harry Dixon Lowes in the 1920s, a white man. Not sure if he really wrote it or not. There's some discrepancy on that. But he wrote it, but it has become really a song for the civil rights movement. It was used frequently in the 50s and 60s. There was one quartet called the Freedom Singers who used to sing it at their Baptist church, black group of singers, who said, you can't just sing it and you can't just say it. You have to belt it out when you're singing This Little Light of Mine. You have to know it to be true. You have to know those words are so true, that there is a light in you. There is that brightness in you. And this song has become the song of the oppressed. It's become the song of the marginalized. It's become a song supposedly written by a white man that is a song for black people, especially in this time. It's a song of inner power and courage and freedom, that no matter what's going on, it can help calm us, it can unify us, it can help us see what is real, what is true, that we have this light inside of us. It's so powerful. Last year in Charlottesville, Virginia, there was a protest going on, a peaceful protest, and then some other groups of people showed up and counter-protesting them, and it could have gotten ugly. But the leaders of the protest decided to start singing "This Little Light of Mine." And it spread throughout, and everybody started singing. And the song settled the tension. It ended up being completely peaceful protest. It was uplifting and encouraging and game-changing. This song is transformational for people, and there are many, many varieties of this song out there. You could Google it and listen to many different versions of this song. But you can't help but feel good. We need to get to know that light inside and let it shine. Jesus says in the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 14 to 16, "You are the light of the world. A city built on a hilltop cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." I love this phrase. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. Metaphysically, that city represents our consciousness, and when it's built on a hill, when we have raised it up, when we know that we have this light within us, when we get to know that light, we can't hide it. We cannot hide our light. It's shining, and it's a beacon to others. It shows the way for everyone when we're willing to do this. It's a higher consciousness. My mentor, Reverend Russ Hyland, was at the commitment march a couple days ago in Washington, D.C., showed pictures of this peaceful march 57 years after Martin Luther King Jr. was there saying, "I have a dream." Thousands of people were there, and my mentor wrote this, or printed this poem on his Facebook post. I'm not sure who to attribute it to. It was part of a book, but it said, "Dear God, place a fire within me. Let me not become comfortable in my current position. Help me move. Amen." We're meant to move. We're meant to shine. We're meant to evolve. We're not meant to be hidden. Our light is not there for us. How dare we even hide it? It's a gift from God. It's spirit. It's spirit longing to come forth through us, as us. And it's meant to be shared. It can be really challenging to do that, to even find that light during times like this. And Unity Teachings, much more so than traditional Christianity, I would say, because Unity says that we have to take responsibility for our own lives. That light is within us means we have to let it shine. We can't put things off and say, "Oh, it was God's will." Where is God? But in us, within us. We have to take responsibility for that light and let it shine. The Revealing Word is one of Unity's metaphysical dictionary, and it says, "Inner light is the illumination of spirit resident in the center of every man's being." That means every man, every woman, every person, every living being on this planet has that same light within. Sometimes it's a little dusty. Sometimes it needs to be cleaned off or allowed to burn. Maybe it's being suffocated. It needs some air. You need to let that light shine. And which means it's up to us to look within and find it. It's up to us to get to know that light and bring it forth. how we experience the events of today, the events we see in our society today, and how we is up to us how we experience them, how we choose to be in these circumstances. We're responsible for whatever comes into our awareness. We're responsible to act, to move, to do, to be that light. On what are we focused? Where is our focus? Aristotle said, it is during our darkest moments that we must focus to see the light. We must focus to see it. Sometimes it's not easy to see it. It's not easy to see the mountains when they're covered with smoke or haze or clouds, to see the sun when it's covered with clouds, but it's there, just like our light is there. My intention for this week's talk was to have something fun, to have the focus be on uplifting and being fun and not so heavy. But I realized this week as I was preparing that my focus has not been on that, that my focus has been on the dark, has been on the dividedness of our country. That's where my focus has been. And so it's challenging to want to bring a talk when I'm not there myself. I needed to go within and find my own light. And I've been hearing that song, This Little Light of Mine, in my head all week. And whenever I caught myself reading something that I was feeding my anger, I had to stop and think, what would joy do? Remember that movie, Inside Out, Disney animated movie about the emotions within? And joy is this light being, and she flutters around, and she's joyful and light, and she's kind of glowing. The other emotions, anger, disgust, fear, sadness, often, you know, smaller. They would say, what would joy do? Try to do that this week. What would joy do? You know, it feels like we're in this dark time with no end in sight. But this is the time for us to focus on the light. This is the time. This is the most important time to focus on the light. To know that there is hope. To know that God wins. Love wins. Goodness wins. Always. It always wins in the end. No matter, looking back throughout history, love and God always wins, always. We need to put that into perspective. We've been living in this time of pandemic, economic downturn, massive layoffs and unemployed, civil unrest, and a greater awareness of racial injustice. And look at that and know that it's only been 6 months for these three things that have come together. I know the racial injustice has been going on for hundreds of years, but look at the age of the earth, 4.5 billion years. The age of humans, or Homo sapiens, 6 million years. And the age of humans as we know us now, 200,000 years. Looking over the span of history, this is a short time, very short. And we're making progress, we're evolving, but evolution takes time. Transition takes time, and there it can be painful to transition. You know, when you're going through the final stages of birth, it's called transition. And that's the most painful part of birth if you don't have drugs. The transition, bringing in this new life, bringing in this new awareness. And that's what I think we're going through right now, that we're bringing in this new awareness. The virus, who knows why the virus came here? What did it come to teach us? But we have this opportunity to slow down, to look at our lives, to determine what our priorities are, to focus on getting to know the light, getting to know that light inside, and that light inside is meant to be shared, and it's meant to shine. This will pass. As we get to know the light inside, what is outside, what is reflected outside, will look different. It always does, because the outside is a reflection of what's going on in us, in our beliefs. The more we focus on the light inside, the more beauty we will see. And we can burst those bubbles of thought that keep us small. We have an outdoor patio service at 9 o'clock. Most of you that are watching probably know that. And this week, I had this great idea. I was going to have us all do something joyful. It's really hard when everyone's got a mask and sunglasses and a hat and can't really tell who's even out there sometimes. And I'm like, are you even awake there? Are you awake there behind that camera, behind that screen? You know, give me an amen on the chat box and let me know if you're awake, if you're with us. But so I thought at the outdoor patio service, we would blow some bubbles. I thought, what a great way to be joyful. What would joy do? Joy would do something playful, something childlike, something to just lift your spirits. Let that light shine. And then I woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning on Friday and realized we're in the middle of a pandemic. I can't ask people to take their masks off and blow bubbles. This virus is spread through aerosols and droplets, which would get right into those bubbles and go all over us. So the bubble idea was a bust. But while I was thinking about the bubbles, and I was going down chasing a lot of squirrels, as they say, and looking at different articles about bubbles. You know, if you ever really look at a bubble, it's got all these beautiful colors. It's a real mixture of beautiful colors, which is a lot like our world. Mixture of beautiful colors, mixture of different viewpoints. The diversity on our planet is amazing, and we can choose to see it as a thing of beauty. It's our choice. And I learned that bubbles, that the light that is reflected from inside the bubble actually travels farther than the outside. Isn't that true with us? The light that comes from inside of us has a much greater reach than anything on the outside of us. That light shines brightly and travels and reaches and says, this way, this way. It's a beautiful thing. So I handed out the bubbles to bring home for people to do in their own yards in a safe way. And they were just a little bottle of bubbles with a very small wand to remind us that start small. You know, if you're not seeing that light, start small. Spend a little time. Get to know that light. How do we do that? Get to know it by spending time with it, just like anyone else we would want to get to know. We spend time with it. Spend time in the silence. Spend time in contemplation. Spend time journaling and in meditation. And spend time knowing your brilliance, your radiance, and then letting it shine. Letting it shine for everyone to see. You know, just a small flame can light a whole room. Your flame can light a whole room, a whole community. These beautiful flames that I see sitting here, our singers and our people working here to help our service get to you via YouTube and Facebook today. So grateful. A small amount of awareness of your divine essence is all it takes. And as you start to know it, start to get to know it, you gain more confidence, you stand taller, you shine brighter. I read an article that called that confidence, Godfidence. Godfidence. That's what it is. Godfidence. Confidence. Godfidence. So do you know that light inside of you? Are you willing to spend some time with it? If you are, write yes in the chat box. Let everybody know, yes, I'm willing to spend some time. I'm willing to gain some Godfidence. And what lights you up? What lights you up is that whatever it is, it's spirit longing to come forth, spirit longing to burst forth and shine brightly. That dream, that excitement is within you, wanting to move through you and as you. And once we can know our light, then we can know that that light is in everyone, every living being, no matter race, no matter gender, no matter sexual orientation, no matter political preferences, that same light is in each of us. It's there. There was a, in the 7th century, there was a boat of refugees that landed on the coast of India. The leader of the refugees went to the leader, went to the king of India and said, "My people would like to be part of your community. We need a place to live." And the king said, "No. You see how full of water my glass is? There's no more room. There's no room for more water, and there's no room for more people in my country." And the leader of the refugees took a teaspoon of sugar, put it in the water, and stirred it up. And as the sugar dissolved, the leader of the refugees said, "Just as the sugar dissolved in your full glass of water, so will my people dissolve into your community and provide a sweetness that you've never known." I love that story, because there's a sweetness that each of us provides when we know our light, when we let our light shine, when we allow others to shine as well. When we get to know the light inside of ourselves, we can see that everyone brings a sweetness. Everyone has a value. And so let us move into a time of meditation right now. I invite you to take that deep breath. Feel yourself centered in, settle in, even a little more. Gently close your eyes. And listen to these words from Martha Smock, Unity Minister, who wrote a piece called "Listen to the Christ." Listen to the voice of Christ that says, from the book of John, chapter 15, verse 16, "You did not choose me, but I chose you. You did not choose me, but I chose you." Whenever you think that you are unimportant, unneeded, remember this: you are here by divine appointment. You are an important part of God's plan, of God's creation. You have your unique role to fill. What have you been chosen to do? You have been chosen to give expression to God, to the Christ qualities. You have been chosen to be a part of the flow of life. You have been chosen to contribute to the good, the happiness, the well-being of the world. You have been chosen to express your particular abilities and talents. You have been chosen to be a light in the world. So I invite you to hold in your mind those words from Jesus. I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world. As we enter a time of stillness.
It's Rachel. I'm over here with all the people. My name is Rachel. I'm the director of community care, and I'd like to welcome anybody who's new here to Columbine and just say we're so glad you're here. This is the time in our service where we collect our offerings, our love offerings, and our tithes, and a little screen to show all the different ways that you can give. If you go right to our website, there's a donate page right there, and the text to give is a great way to give. And you just text give to the number on the screen, and it leads you right through it. So let's say our offertory blessing together.
God's love has always met and will always meet all my needs. I give freely, I receive abundantly, and I am grateful.
So fun. There was a different font on that. I like notice that so things are changing. So I just want to just say thank you for being here today. And we had such a lovely 9 a.m. service this morning out in the nice cool weather. It's starting to change. Every season there's the day where the seasons change and the last 2 days were that day, that we are now on the other end and it will start to be fall. So just such an appreciation of everyone being here. If you are new and you want to be on our email list and receive our updates, you can go right to the website and it will give you the information on how to be able to be on our contact list. Also, videos. If you loved Sue's talk today and you want to share it, you can go onto our website and watch it again and share it with your friends. So we'd love for you to go to our website. So I found this picture, reach out and touch someone. Like, remember, like, when you had the phone and you had to push the buttons? Like, it was the dial, right? and the reach out and touch someone. And I just have been thinking so much about all of you and missing you so much. And I haven't had as much time as I want to reach out and touch everyone. So, you know, we had the communication team. But this is really like, if you're thinking to yourself, Cindy, I wonder how Cindy's doing. Then you can look in Breeze and look up people's phone numbers and do text, email, or calls. And let's just reach out and touch someone. If you have questions about Breeze or don't know how to access your account, I'm here Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays, and I'm happy to help you in any way that I can. Okay, what's next, Bonnie? Today was the beginning of the Youth and Family Ministries spiritual education, and Christopher and his team were downstairs at 10:15 on Zoom, breaking the kids out into different groups. And if you didn't participate and you want to, you can contact Christopher. Or let's say you are actually in Minnesota, or your grandkids are in Minnesota, or somewhere across the country. Now that we're doing all this stuff on Zoom, you can offer this spiritual education to kids no matter where they are. So I really encourage everybody to sign up and talk to Christopher about it. It's going to be great. So the fall program begins September 20th. We're going to be studying radical forgiveness. Ooh. And we do, every year, we do spring and fall. And this is a 7-week program where we all read the same book. The talks on Sundays will be on the chapters of the book, and then we meet into small groups. When COVID hit in the spring, we moved that to Zoom, and it worked out really well. We're going to do the same thing for the fall. We've got 14 or 15 groups. They're going to range between 10 and 20 people. Janice and I are taking larger groups, and I'm going to break them into smaller groups. We're going to try something new. And so we really encourage everybody, no matter where you are in the country, no matter what's going on, please sign up for a group so that we can connect. This is how we connect. And so I wish, just like on Zoom, that I could see all your little faces that are watching right now or watching later. And we really have had an opportunity to really connect via Zoom. So those signups were in the e-bulletin that you received today. It's in the update. And if you go to our website on September 20th, there is a link to all the signups. And again, my name is Rachel, and I'm here to help in any way that I can. So lastly, we have Zelloship after service today. I will be there with my jingly bells on at 12:15. And we just have this opportunity to really, again, see each other in our little squares and share what's going on in our lives. And everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. So we would love to have you join us. And if you ever have anything that you need, we really, our staff, our whole staff is here to help you in whatever way that we can. So, and I just want to say a shout out to Janice for what you do for us in song and how she never gives up. And she didn't mention that we had our Chris who and Kevin who did it, and our rhythm section that was here. We got all set up, and then it rained, and then we had to bring all the stuff in, and then we had to wait for the rainstorm to pass, and then we had to come back, and it was really great. So we're going to hear another Janice song at the end. So thank you all for being here today. We love and miss you.
Oh, are we ready to stand? Go ahead and stand, everybody. If you're at home, you can stand. If you're with a loved one, hold hands, and let's sing ourselves out.
Yeah.
take. Let this be my joyous vow.
Surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.
Amen.
We're going to sing about knowing our own worth. Super simple. There's even some oohs in it.
I deserve.
Everybody, we love you.
We love you. You deserve it.